What's up, ducks? If you love silly antics, cartoonish gags, and classic characters, then there's no doubt that Looney Tunes is your cup of tea. It's definitely one of ours. Hi, folks, I'm Joe with Channel Frederator, and it's time to hunt some wabbit trivia with our 107 facts about Looney Tunes. Let's get started. Looney Tunes was created in 1930 when producer Leon Schlesinger partnered with former Disney artists Hugh Harmon and Rudolph Ising, who had recently started their own animation studio. Many of the pair's early cartoons would be similar to their work for Disney. The duo's pilot short, Bosco the Talk Ink Kid, was among the first non-Disney cartoons to feature synchronized speech. Schlesinger was so impressed that he secured a deal with the young animators. Schlesinger, who was not an animator, pitched his idea for cartoon films directly to Jack Warner. Warner reportedly agreed to Schlesinger's contract option 7 minutes after viewing his first animated short. The deal would help usher in the golden age of animation, which ran from the late 1920s until the late 1960s. The Harmon-Ising studio was essentially subcontracted to handle the animation for Schlesinger. At the time, cartoon shorts would often accompany feature-length productions. The first Looney Tunes cartoon, Sinkin' in the Bathtub, was released in April 1930. This 8-minute short featured Bosco and his girlfriend, Honey, singing and dancing along with popular songs of the day. Sinkin' in the Bathtub didn't look much like the classic shorts that feature Bugs, Daffy, and Porky. It was in black and white with little dialogue and virtually no story. However, the film does conclude with Bosco saying the signature Looney Tunes line, "That's all, folks." All of the original Looney Tunes featured Bosco and his friends. Harmon and Ising created about one animated short based on them every month. After about a year of this production schedule, Schlesinger began producing another series called Merry Melodies. Merry Melodies was created to showcase songs from the massive Warner Brothers music catalog. The first cartoon from the series, Lady Play Your Mandolin, starred Foxy and Roxy, two foxes that bore a striking resemblance to Disney's Mickey and Minnie Mouse. The titles Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies were both parodies of Walt Disney's Silly Symphonies cartoons. All three series were originally based on the idea of combining music with animation. From its conception in 1931, every Merry Melodies short was intended to highlight a tune from the Warner Brothers catalog. The title of each release would be based on the song featured in the cartoon. Merry Melodies also differed from Looney Tunes in that the series would not feature recurring characters. However, the differences between the two series would eventually fade. Financial disputes caused Harmon and Ising to part ways with Schlesinger in 1933. By that point, their studio had created 39 Looney Tunes and 27 Merry Melodies that would take the popular Bosco character with them to MGM. Following the departure of Harmon and Ising, Schlesinger formed his own animation studio for Warner Brothers in Hollywood, Leon Schlesinger Productions. While it took some time for Leon Schlesinger Productions to find success, the studio made several important hires early on. Ben Bugs Hardaway, Fred Tex Avery, and Chuck Jones, all of whom would be considered legendary animators. The style, humor, and animation quality of a Warner Brothers cartoon could vary greatly based on which director and unit handled the production. Even the look and demeanor of famous characters would change from release to release. This was especially true when new tunes were developed in early appearances. Tex Avery was the first standout cartoon director at Warner Brothers. While many of the other animators were more focused on Disney-esque realism, Avery began using story gags that contradicted reality. He also sped up the pace of many cartoons. Avery was so focused on gags that his jokes often came at the expense of the animation. In the Warner Brothers studio, Avery had a reputation for being more interested in jokes than the quality of artwork. During this time, Warner Brothers cartoons were often rushed productions with low budgets. Animators would spend 4 to 5 weeks completing shorts, whereas at Disney, directors would spend about twice that amount of time on a release. They were also working on new things. The first Warner Brothers cartoon to be filmed in color was the 1934's Honeymoon Hotel. This Merry Melodies release, which was about a bug couple going on their honeymoon, utilized the early Cinecolor two-color process. Starting in 1936, all of the Merry Melody cartoons would be shot in color. The Looney Tunes releases would remain in black and white until 1942. Warner Brothers animator Bob Clampett said that in the 1930s, the black and white Looney Tunes were seen as second tier to all the color Merry Melodies. He claimed that studio execs would look down on the older series. Since Warner Brothers lost the rights to Bosco, Schlesinger was desperate to find a new star character for Looney Tunes. Animator Tom Palmer created Buddy to fill this void in 1933. Unlike most of the studio's early tunes, who were anthropomorphic animals, Buddy was an animated human boy. But Buddy wasn't the biggest hit. So, Schlesinger and Warner Brothers finally got their first bona fide star in 1935 when Porky Pig officially debuted in I Haven't Got a Hat. This short was written to introduce several new characters, including Beans the Cat, Little Kitty, and the twins, Ham and X. The original Porky looked very different than his later incarnations. He was a child and was much larger, and wore a green sweater. However, he still had the everyman quality that would later help make him an icon. The name Porky Pig was inspired by two children that animator Friz Freeland knew while growing up in Kansas City. Freeland combined their childhood names, Porky and Piggy, to create the moniker of the famous tune. Porky was originally voiced by actor Joe Doherty. While many cartoon characters of the 1930s spoke in a high falsetto voice, Doherty used his natural stutter to give Porky a unique voice. Doherty's genuine speech impediment eventually made recording sessions too difficult. The voice role of Porky would soon switch over to Mel Blanc, who would later portray many of the most famous Warner Brothers cartoon characters. Before Blanc was hired, most of the Looney Tunes characters were voiced by radio announcers and contract players off the Warner lot. Blanc was more like an actor in that he could alter his voice in many expressive ways. This helped him earn his nickname, the Man of a Thousand Voices. That's all, folks. 1937's Rover's Revival was the first Looney Tunes cartoon to feature Porky Pig's iconic send-off. Once Porky was identified as the studio star, he would appear in all of the Looney Tunes releases. This would continue throughout the second half of the 1930s until Daffy Duck became popular. Porky's Duck Hunt from 1937 featured the first appearance of Daffy Duck. At this point, the character had yet to be named, and featured a higher-pitched voice that would later be used as Woody Woodpecker. Daffy got his first role as a fully formed character in You Oughta Be In Pictures. In the short, Daffy convinces Porky to relinquish his status as the Warner Brothers' top cartoon star. The release combines live-action with animation and features Leon Schlesinger in a cameo. Chuck Jones referred to Daffy as a character so honest it hurts. Daffy could be wild and sneaky in a way that made him quite different from the everyman quality of Porky. Daffy's signature line, "You're despicable," was delivered by Mel Blanc with an exaggerated lisp. Jones said that when he originally wrote the phrase, he thought it would be a quirky throwaway, not a famous saying. The catchphrase, "Suffer and Succotash," was also originated by Daffy Duck, who says it in 1945's "Ain't That Ducky." The line would later become more famous as the catchphrase for Sylvester the Cat. Both characters were known for their heavy lisps. In the early 1940s, Warner Brothers began to make conscious efforts to distinguish the look of Daffy Duck from his cartoon cousin, Donald Duck. The animators aimed to make Daffy essentially look like a human in a duck suit. This would be a major departure from earlier appearances when he was drawn more like a real duck. The early version of Elmer Fudd was actually called Egghead, and first appeared in a 1937 Merry Melody release. Over the next 3 years, the character's appearance and personality would slowly morph into that of a buffoonish hunter. Elmer was one of the more famous characters not to be voiced by Mel Blanc. Instead, the voice was handled by radio performer Arthur Q. Bryan, who gave Elmer a speech impediment that made his R and L sounds come out as a W. His catchphrase would become, "Shh, be very, very quiet. I'm hunting wabbits." In 1940, Elmer would be paired with a rabbit for the first time in Elmer's Candid Camera. The early version of Bugs Bunny featured in this short was drawn with an apricot-colored mouth and had a rural voice far removed from his classic New York accent. Despite the differences, this Bugs prototype still managed to get the better of Elmer. The classic version of Bugs Bunny would debut in the 1940 Tex Avery-directed short, A Wild Hare. While facing his nemesis, Elmer Fudd, Bugs would say, "What's up, Doc?" for the first time. Bugs made such an impression that the studio immediately started to cultivate the character as a potential star. This happened despite Avery's poor assessment of his own film, which he later said hardly featured any funny gags. The name Bugs came from the nickname of animation director Ben Bugs Hardaway. A fellow animator was given the task of creating a rabbit for one of Hardaway's cartoons. After making the model sheet of the character, he labeled it Bugs Bunny. Previously, Bugs Bunny went by a different name, Happy Rabbit. Yeah, it just doesn't have the same ring to it. Good thing Mel Blanc suggested the name change. Unlike most comedic cartoons from the era, Bugs was depicted as a confident hero. Chuck Jones later noted that even Mickey Mouse only ever succeeded in spite of his mistakes. When creating the voice for Bugs, Mel Blanc was told to make the character a tough stinker. He decided to combine the two toughest voices he knew, accents from Brooklyn and the Bronx. Bugs Bunny's carrot-chomping stance was a parody of Clark Gable in the movie It Happened One Night, who also chews on a carrot while talking. Not all of the classic Warner Brothers cartoons were laugh fests filled with silly gags and fanciful animation. Old Glory, a patriotic Porky vehicle from 1939, and Tom Thumb in Trouble, a tale about a young boy who nearly drowns from 1940, were both virtually free of jokes. By the early 1940s, Disney had found success with feature-length animated films. Despite this, Schlesinger routinely shot down any suggestions that his studio should create a full-length feature. He simply did not have the manpower of animators to indulge imagine anything past an 8 minute short. In 1943, Schlesinger ordered all Looney Tunes releases to be in color. By that point, the old studio rule preventing recurring characters from appearing in Merry Melodies had also been done away with. Film critic Leonard Maltin has recognized the 1940s as a boom period for Warner Brothers cartoons. He praised the releases from Tex Avery and Frank Tashlin as some of the sharpest, funniest cartoons of the era. Many of the silly gags featured in the Warner Brothers cartoons were also generated outside the studio offices. Bob Clampett said that he and head writer Ernest Gee would come up with stories while playing table tennis at night. Clampett started his career as an animator at Warner Brothers when he was only 17. As a director for the studio, he would be known for pushing the boundaries of animated motion, surreal gags, and irreverent humor. His film, Porky and Wacky Land, which was inducted into the National Film Registry in 2000, is often cited as one of his defining efforts. It was not uncommon for cartoons throughout the first half of the 20th century to include jokes or characters based on insensitive ethnic stereotypes. For the most part, Warner Brothers would remove such offensive parts from the shorts for TV broadcasts. However, there were some cartoons deemed too objectionable to air even after edits. These releases became known as the Censored 11. Many Warner Brothers cartoons contained morbid humor, with gags that involved gunplay and suicide. For example, Ballot Box Bunny ends with Bugs Bunny and Yosemite Sam playing Russian roulette. A number of Warner Brothers shorts of the 1940s fell into a standard two-character formula. These plots would simply pit two characters with antagonistic interests against each other. For animators, such self-contained formulas made production easier and more efficient. Bugs' nemesis, Yosemite Sam, made his first appearance in the 1945 release Hair Trigger. Writer Michael Maltese said he partly based the character on Friz Freleng, who directed the short. Both Sam and Friz were short redheads who wore mustaches. Marvin the Martian was created because Bugs Bunny needed an adversary who was the opposite of Yosemite Sam. While Sam was loud and obnoxious, Marvin was quiet, soft-spoken, and incredibly destructive. The first short to pair Tweety and Sylvester together was 1947's Tweety Pie. This was also the first Warner Brothers cartoon to win the Academy Award for Best Animated Short Film. The Hanna-Barbera studio had won this category the previous 4 years with its Tom and Jerry cartoons. Leon Schlesinger sold his animation studio for $700,000 to Warner Brothers in 1944. He would step down as boss but remain associated with the studio by retaining 25% of profits for merchandising. In 1949, Schlesinger died of an abdominal ailment at the age of 65. Following its sale, the studio would be renamed Warner Brothers Cartoons, Inc. and be headed by Edward Seltzer. Like Schlesinger before him, Seltzer had no animation experience. This was during a time when directors and writers would meet for jam sessions. The meat of a good story idea would be lots of gags. Writer Michael Maltese, who worked with Chuck Jones on many releases, said he would have to often visually perform many of his ideas to the directors. Perhaps the most beloved collaboration between Jones and Maltese was the short What's Opera, Doc?, a parody of the works of 19th century classical composer Richard Wagner. In 1992, it became the first Warner Brothers cartoon selected for preservation in the National Film Registry. Jones later insisted that there are no gags in What's Opera, Doc? The animators thought that a rabbit and a hunter working in a fully Wagnerian environment would be funny enough. While a typical cartoon at Warner Brothers took about 5 weeks to produce, What's Opera, Doc? Required seven. Since management would have scoffed at this extra time, the animators took a week from two of the Roadrunner cartoons. Jones claims that studio head Eddie Seltzer never submitted What's Opera, Doc? To the Academy because he didn't like the film. Thus, what is often considered Jones's masterpiece never received an Oscar nomination. As the popularity of television began affecting the film industry in the 50s and 60s, the number of theatrical animated shorts tapered off. Warner Brothers cartoons countered this by creating the Bugs Bunny Show in 1960, which ran on ABC. This program would play the old Warner Brothers color cartoons. The Bugs Bunny Show, which would sometimes air under the other names like the Bugs Bunny and Tweety Show, lasted 4 decades on American television. Not long after the Bugs Bunny Show ended its original primetime run in 1962, Warner Brothers cartoons closed down. DFE Films, an animation production company started by two former Warner Brothers animators, took up the old studio space in 1963. Bob McKimson, who started with the studio when Harmon and Ising were still animating, was the only person to have worked with Looney Tunes from start to finish. By the time Warner Brothers cartoons closed, he was a director. After the studio's closure, DFE Films was subcontracted to make new animated shorts for Warner Brothers. The last Warner Brothers cartoon of this period to be released theatrically was called Engine Trouble. Warner Brothers released a string of Looney Tunes compilation films to theaters in the 70s and 80s. The first movie, Bugs Bunny Superstar, intermixed 9 classic shorts with narration by Orson Welles. Chuck Jones' absence from Bugs Bunny Superstar was notable. Only one of the legendary director's shorts was included in the film. That problem was rectified with the release of the second Warner Brothers cartoon compilation, The Bugs Bunny Roadrunner Movie. This 1979 release featured only Jones-directed cartoons. For nearly two decades, there were no more new Looney Tunes shorts in theaters. The Duxorcist finally ended the drought when it was released in 1987. The music for most of the Warner Brothers cartoons was handled by composer Carl Stalling. Stalling set himself apart from other animated film composers in that he would use short bits of famous melodies and interlock them with original material. His music was often designed to reference and enhance the gags on screen. A 25-member orchestra was typically used to score the Warner Brothers cartoons. Stalling and his musicians also had the option to use any song in the studio's vast publishing catalog. Some of the most famous orchestra pieces that Stalling used include Ride of the Valkyries, William Tell Overture, and Hungarian Rhapsody No. 2. For many children, Warner Brothers cartoons would provide an introduction to such classics. After Stalling retired, Milt Franklin took over as the studio's musical director. Franklin has been praised for his loud, quiet dynamics and a use of an array of instruments. The opening theme music for the Looney Tunes series was The Merry-Go-Round Broke Down by Cliff Friend and Dave Franklin. Merry Melodies would use a similarly jaunty tune, Merrily We Roll Along, which was written by Charles Tobias, Murray Mencher, and Eddie Cantor. Another major trademark of the Warner Brothers cartoons was the elaborate sound effects. Adding these unique touches involved splicing in sounds that were recorded on film. Sound effects editor Treg Brown was responsible for adding many of the iconic noises heard in the Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies releases. TV Guide dubbed Bugs Bunny the greatest cartoon character of all time, with Daffy Duck, Tweety, Sylvester, Wile E. Coyote, Roadrunner, and Porky Pig all cracking the top 50 as well. So the next time some young whippersnapper tries to tell you that SpongeBob is better than Bugs Bunny, you just send them to this video. In his first appearance, Tweety Bird was pink and naked. He was later given his signature yellow feathers in response to criticisms that he was originally naked. Tweety wasn't even originally named Tweety. He first went by Orson, which is nowhere near as cute. Sylvester the Cat was originally named Thomas when he first appeared in Tweety Pie. Let's see, a cat named Thomas stalking an uncatchable and adorable prey. Sound familiar? It's no wonder why Warner Brothers changed his name to Sylvester. The E in Wile E. Coyote stands for Ethelbert, which is a family name. The name was revealed in the comic The Greatest of E's. In the comic, Wile E realizes that he doesn't even know what the E stands for, so he enlists the help of his family to figure it out. Wile E. Coyote orders all his contraptions from the Acme Corporation. But have you ever wondered where the name Acme came from? It goes way back to the days of phone books. In the Yellow Pages, businesses often rebranded to assert themselves to the top of alphabetized phone books. So Acme was a very common business name at the time. Tasmanian Devil is one of the most popular Looney Tunes characters, but he's only actually appeared in 5 Looney Tunes shorts, though fortunately, he's got his own spin-off TV show in 1991 called Tasmania. While he may look nothing like his real-life counterparts, Tasmanian Devil has helped researchers save lives of real Tasmanian devils from a disease that wiped out over 90% of the population. The Toledo Zoo donated $500,000 to a program that monitors Tasmanian devils in the wild in exchange for 3 devils for the zoo. The zoo director postulates that without Taz, awareness for Tasmanian devils would be non-existent and the species would have been beyond saving. So, go Taz! In 1961, Mel Blanc got in a serious car accident that left him in a coma for weeks. Eventually, a doctor tried to get the unresponsive patient to talk by asking him, "Bugs Bunny, how are you doing today?" Blanc woke up and responded in Bugs' voice, "What's up, Doc?" Blanc survived the car accident and lived until 1989. Bugs Bunny was the first cartoon character to ever appear on a stamp when he made his postal debut in 1997 on a 32-cent postage stamp. He currently sits at the 7th most popular collectible US stamp. Despite being one of the nation's most beloved cartoon characters, Bugs' appearance on a stamp proved to be surprisingly controversial, with many people worrying that it would make stamps too commercialized, and others were outraged that Mickey Mouse wasn't the first. It turns out that even NASA loves the Looney Tunes. In 2005, NASA landed 2 rovers on Mars, Spirit and Opportunity. Marvin the Martian appeared on the official NASA patch for the crew in charge of operating the Spirit rover, while Daffy Duck as Duck Dodgers appeared on the crew for the Opportunity rover. In In 1991, the National Stuttering Project of San Francisco picketed the Warner Brothers studio because they felt that Porky belittled stutterers. Ultimately, the studio donated a $12,000 grant to the Stuttering Foundation of America and released a series of anti-bullying PSAs starring Porky Pig. Google has a hidden language interface that allows you to change the language to Elmer Fudd speak. It replaces all L's and R's to W's, and to a search and try it out. TV Guide rated the Looney Tunes as the third greatest cartoon of all time, with The Simpsons and The Flintstones occupying the first and second spots respectively. The Looney Tunes cast have been spokespersons for nearly everything. Cars, DSL, cereal, the Yellow Pages, auto insurance, TV dinners, credit cards, batteries, candy, cat food, and even car wax. Who says cartoons don't make you smart? Bugs Bunny changed the face of modern dictionaries. Nimrod used to be synonymous with the biblical mighty hunter, until Bugs Bunny used it to sarcastically describe the inept Elmer Fudd. Generations later, Nimrod now appears in the dictionary with two very different and almost contradictory meanings. In 1988, several Looney Tunes characters appeared in Who Framed Roger Rabbit, an homage to film noir and the golden age of animation. The movie, which combined live action with animation, gave audiences their first chance to see toons like Daffy Duck and Bugs Bunny together with Disney characters. The Looney Tunes gang would not get their own full-length theatrical movie until the release of Space Jam in 1996. While the film received mixed reviews, the box office totals were impressive. According to Box Office Mojo, Space Jam is the highest-grossing basketball movie of all time, raking in a lifetime gross of over $90 million. The genesis of Space Jam came from a series of Nike ads released from 1992 to 1993 that featured Michael Jordan and Bugs Bunny. These Hair Jordan commercials were so popular that Warner Brothers decided to invest in a feature film based on the idea. The success of Space Jam led to immediate talks of a sequel. Space Jam 2 was put in motion a year after the original's release, with Mel Brooks set to voice the film's villain. However, Michael Jordan wasn't interested in reprising his role. Warner Brothers subsequently dropped the production. Speedy found himself in the middle of a big controversy during the past 20 years. In 1999, Cartoon Network stopped airing Speedy Gonzalez cartoons over concerns that the character was racist. However, 3 years later, in 2002, the fastest mouse in Mexico ran his way back to Cartoon Network after the fans campaigned to have him put back on the air. The campaign sent a big message to WB because Speedy Gonzalez is even getting his own debut on the silver screen. A fully animated feature film titled Speedy is currently in production. Despite all the previous drama, one of the movie producers said that in a time when Donald Trump is gaining momentum, the world needs Speedy more than ever. Eugenio Derbez will take up the mantle of Speedy's voice, and the movie is set to be released in both English and Spanish. There's been a bunch of spin-offs that came out of Looney Tunes. The Bugs Bunny show and its combo show with Roadrunner, and later Tweety Bird, ran the longest, starting in the 1960s and ending in 2000. 4 decades long! Then you have the Roadrunner show, which aired between the years of 1966 and 1973, Tiny Toon Adventures from 1990 to 1995, Tasmania between 1991 to 1995, The Sylvester Tweety Mysteries, 1995 to 2000, Baby Looney Tunes, 2002 to 2006, Duck Dodgers from 2003 to 2005, Lunatics Unleashed, 2005 to 2007, and The Looney Tunes Show from 2011 to 2014. Nowadays, Looney Tunes fans can catch Bugs and the gang on Cartoon Network's Wabbit. It's sort of a perfect name for the show, right? Including the new 3D theatrical shorts, there are over 1,000 Looney Tunes and Merry Melodies cartoons to date, and that doesn't count spin-offs, webtoons, or TV specials. Whew! There's a lot of Looney Tunes out there in the world, so better start binging. Once again, I'm Joe, and thanks for watching 107 Facts About Looney Tunes. Who's your favorite character? Did we miss anything? Comment below and let us know. Don't forget to click the bell icon to become part of the notification squad. We have videos dropping every day, so make sure to subscribe to Channel Frederator, your Cartoon Central on the internet.